So I came down on my front tire, bam, handlebars, head, neck, and my body slapped onto the earth. And then I was completely out at that time. I mean, there might have been a moment where I felt just a little bit of pain, but it was like, I wasn't going there. I was out.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Tyler Deal. How are you doing, Tyler?
I'm doing well, thank you. How are you, Alex?
I'm doing very well, my friend. Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your journey with all of us. So my very first question to you, my friend, is what was your life like prior to your near-death experience?
Well, I was a fairly depressed person, I would say. I mean, as a kid in the younger years, I was happy. I felt like I was very connected to nature, and I had a sensitivity that was, I looked at as just natural as a kid. And then as I got older, our family had moved to another state. And then as I got older, I began to experience a lot of emotional pain that I didn't want to look at. And so I had suppressed that pain. And through my teenage years, I went back to California for college, and it seemed like all of that suppressed sadness was resurfaced, basically. And so at that time, I didn't want to look at it, but I had my own way of coping, which was to go into do mountain biking and to go into the forest. And the forest became, the trees became my friends, and the forest became my sanctuary. So that's how I coped. However, there was still that pressure. That was still that imminent pressure of not being able to look at myself. And I felt like there was something wrong with me. And that became kind of an internal dialogue. Basically, there's something wrong with me. There's something wrong with me. And it got so bad that I started to have a conversation with God, with the divine, saying, I don't want to be here anymore. Please take me. It's too rough. Please take me. And that led up to my near-death experience. It was the end of my second year of college, and I was looking for a job. I felt very disconnected from people. I felt like nobody liked me. Of course, it was a reflection of how I was feeling inside. You know, I felt, you know, you when you're feeling this pain, you feel like you're the only one on the planet that's right. Experiencing.
Yeah.
And you know, little did I know at the time that there's always somebody that's suffering more than you or going through a harder time than you, wherever that may be in the world. And I didn't know that then. I just felt like this is my world. This is my pain.
Yeah. So before you continue, I wanted to ask you, because I think it's a something to really kind of dig into a little bit, because so many of us do this. When you were having these internal conversations, the kind of spiraling that you were doing was all self-inflicted on based on pain that you've dealt with when you were younger. It was just kind of this conversation that the egoic mind was just telling you these stories in your head, and you just kind of started kind of like spiral more and more because of these conversations, these kind of toxic conversations you were having with yourself.
I believe that's part of it, but I also believe it had to do with some of the traumatic experiences that I was dealing with as a child that I didn't want to look at. So it was actually the trauma that I had experienced, I felt, and I didn't know this at the time, was in a, and it was reflected, I guess you could say, psychologically or from the egoic mind. And so it was a culmination of the two, but it's still one and the same. If you look at it,
of course, of course. Yeah. So then tell me what happened the day of your near death experience. How did you get to that place?
So I just finished semester. I was biking around town, little town in Northern California. And I was at that point, it was like, take me, God, I can't do this. I don't want to be here. And so about 4 days later, I went to the forest mountain biking like I had always done. And so, you know, it was just another day of being depressed, but also at the same time, trying to find that peace and being with the trees. And so I went into the forest. It was morning time. It was, you know, kind of that June gloom in California. There was that mist that was coming by. It was in May. And then it was clearing. It was starting to clear. And I was probably there for a couple hours. And then I started to head back down towards town, because there's the community forest was very close to the little town and to the college where I was attending. So I was familiar with all the trails. And I took a trail that was parallel to one of the roads and started to hit the jumps. I never wore a helmet. I didn't think it was a cool thing to do, really. I mean, because I wasn't an extreme mountain biker, you know, you're 20-year-old kid. You're just like, I'm going to do it. You know, I'm invincible, right? So so I take the jumps like I always had. And then the very last jump that I took, I noticed that it had been built up incredibly. I mean, I was familiar with it on past days, but somebody had built it up. But by that time, it was too late for me. I took that jump, and I knew once I was in the air that this was the moment, basically, that God had given me. It was like a quick knowing, oh, I'm dead. So I came down on my front tire, bam, handlebars, head, neck, and my body slapped onto the earth. And then I was completely out at that time. I mean, there might have been a moment where I felt just a little bit of pain, but it was like, I wasn't going there. I was out. So the next moment of what I had remembered is I was floating above the redwood trees. I can't say it was like an astral body projection. I don't know. Some of your viewers might know what that is, but it was more so it was just like my consciousness, my beingness. And it was a moment where everything became quiet. There was a silence, and yet I was very, very sensitized to the elements around me. And I could feel, for example, the wind blowing through me. I could hear birds, and I could hear dogs miles away, although it sounded like they were right there in my ears barking or chirping. I could see an incredible amount of detail. I could see the detail of like the crystals on the redwood needles of the trees. I could hear the ocean, which was several miles away. And again, there was this incredible amount of peace. And it was like, okay, well, here I am. But there was a familiarity in this space. It was like, this is who I am. I knew who I was at this place. And I didn't know who I was. I really didn't know who I was at all in that body who was so depressed. So let's see. It's when I tell the story, it's interesting because it's like there's all these moments in time, but it's not like time was real at all. And so I looked down and I saw my body. And I saw me all curled up on the ground there in the redwood forest. And I was like, okay, that's not really who I am. And I began to kind of enjoy the space of this peace, incredible amount of peace where I was. And at that moment, or at some moment, there was a question that bubbled up inside me. It was like, it wasn't like hearing a voice. I never saw any beings or angels during this experience. It was more of the presence of nature more than anything. But there was this direct question that came, do you want to go further or do you want to go back? And I said, I don't want to die. And as soon as I said, I don't want to die, I was slammed back into my body. And there was an incredible amount, like, there was a heavy breathing because I knew that I must have lost my breath at that time. I was breathing. And then as I was breathing, I began to feel the pain. And it was a tremendous amount. It was a horrific amount of pain. Electrical pain. It was like a numbing, stabbing pain coursing throughout my body. And I'm thinking, I'm not even really thinking. I'm just like, why the hell did I come back, really, basically. As I was experiencing this pain simultaneously, it began to open my eyes the best that I knew how. Everything was a little bit blurry at that time. And that's when I began to have this experience with fairies, little fairies, like forest fairies, coming down from the trees. They were dive bombing me. They were giggling. They were moving around me. So they were like basically like my little angels. And I believe that they were bringing lightness, that they were bringing love to my situation, or they were welcoming me back here into this earthly experience. So that was that. Simultaneously, I began to hear this amazing humming sound. It was like, it was more than a humming. It was more like a symphony. I explain it as the best way I know how to explain it is like a Tibetan singing bowl, where it's ringing this piece. And I knew it was from the trees. And I could feel this vibration coming into my body. And I believe that the trees at that time were healing me. They were, they were sending that energy down and healing me. So this simultaneously, I'm just kind of like, what's going on? And then I kind of brought my attention back with my breath. And that's when I felt the pain again. And as soon as I started to feel that tremendous amount of pain, it's like I didn't, something happened where I didn't want to go there. And I completely, I was out again. I was, my consciousness went out. So the next thing I remember, I was woken up in the hospital by the doctor who was asking me a series of questions. First thing I heard was, you're very lucky. You're very lucky. You're very lucky. You didn't die. You didn't break any bones. You're very lucky. And so, and then he began to ask me questions, you know, what's your name? I didn't know my name. You know, what town are you? Where are you? I didn't know any of these things at all. And he finally, he asked me one question. He says, do you know any phone number? And I blurted out a phone number that from a family friend in town. It just came out. And so I was released that day, actually that evening from the hospital. I was given some pain medication. I went to my family friends. However, I was still experiencing a tremendous amount of pain, even though I was taking these meds. And so I stayed there for about a week because the doctor wanted me to rest. And so I stayed there for about a week before my mom flew down and picked me up. And I went back up to Washington State.
All right. So before we continue, I want to kind of go back a little bit and dive into the actual experience. I've probably interviewed probably 50 or so now near-death experiencers. You're the first. This is very unique to me. I haven't heard the nature aspect of things. Do you believe that your experience when you were seeing fairies or when you're hearing this ringing from the trees, do you think that was you were still kind of in this near-death experience at that point? You were kind of in and out at that time, and this was kind of customized for you because of your affection for the trees and for nature and what that meant to you emotionally?
Yeah, I believe it was customized. Absolutely. And I never really thought about that, that I was, if I were, was still in my near-death experience by being on the ground, because I was kind of in and out experiencing pain and also seeing the fairies and feeling the trees. So that seems accurate to me, that I was still, it wasn't the same experience as when I was up above floating. But it was, yeah, you could say that it was still within that realm.
Yeah. You weren't all the way back, but you weren't all the way the other side. You were kind of in this kind of in between, kind of like you're not asleep, you're not awake. You're kind of in that in between state.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, that you're just not exactly sleeping. You're not exactly awake, but it seems to me as you were telling the story that that made sense because, and then the customizable aspect of it, because of your, if you would have told me I'm a city boy, the first time I've ever been in the forest and this happened to you, this would make no sense to me. But because of your affection for, and not only affection, but the resource that was nature to you. It was a coping mechanism for you to survive in life, essentially.
Yeah. And it always has been to some degree. It's, you know, even when I was in Washington, I would love to go in the mountains and ski, or we had a county forest behind us where we had lived, and I was always in the woods. So it always was you could call it, I mean, in a way you could call it therapy, but it was more than that for me. It felt like, and it still does to this day, that nature and the trees are my family.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's reflective of that. And maybe Alex, it's you probably see this with other near death experiences. It's, you know, if you believe in hell, they might go there. If you believe in God, you might speak to God. So that makes the most sense to me, that it would be nature that was there supporting me.
Yeah, that from my experience is that whatever the person's beliefs are is kind of how they want to make you feel as comfortable as possible through the transition, through the experience, is from my experience talking to so many NDEers, and it's really customized. And there has been a couple of guests who've gone to a hell, and then they even said, I created that because that was my belief system, that I believe that I had to go through that before I was saved, and these kind of things. But yours is, again, very unique. I've never heard of the nature aspect of a near-death experience before. So it's fairly fascinating to me. Did you even really think about fairies or anything like that prior to this? I mean, you're a 20-year-old dude. I'm imagining that you're not, like, you know, have a ton of fairies all over the place.
Well, I there was an experience I had prior. I was seeing a woman. I was in love with this person, and my heart was very open. And I had an experience at one point when I was in her apartment or in her house. And this was still in the same area, where I had my eyes closed, and I had my, I guess you could call it like your third eye vision turned on, or your inner vision turned on. And I did see them in clarity. I saw those fairies floating around. They weren't making any noises, but I could see like little sparkles within my vision at that time. So that was like my only experience I had about them. I mean, I had read about them prior to that when I was a teenager, you know, but I never really explored it, or I never really did any research about it. And
right.
I really,
you didn't have t-shirts of fairies and didn't have your house dressed up in fairies. It wasn't, my point is, it's not a thing that you were like obsessed with or anything like that. It just like, yeah, I've heard of fairies. Most human beings have heard of fairies or gnomes or, you know, these kind of mythological creatures. But I'm just curious, like, that was my question, is like, was this a major part of your life? Apparently it wasn't. Like, you just might have saw them, or you've heard of them and knew what they were, like most people do at this, you know, Tinkerbell. We all know what Tinkerbell is, essentially.
Right.
You know, but this, and when you're going through this, I have to imagine you went through this trauma of this accident, and you go through this near-death experience, and you're back home and you're still in pain. Are you saying to yourself, what just happened? And did I see fairies? And were the trees singing to me? How did you process all of this? Because again, you were in this weird in-between space, because you weren't on the other side. Because if you were on the other side 100%, again, from my experience, you understand what's going on. But because you were kind of in this weird in-between space, did you question what you saw? What did you go through?
I didn't so much question what I saw, because I believed that there, and I believed at that time anything was possible.
Sure.
And I think that more so the processing took a while. It wasn't immediate. I mean, I was so focused on my body pain and getting well that I wasn't like, what the hell happened? But I was, my memory, because I had I did have a really bad concussion, so my memory wasn't all there completely. So it took a while, as I started to get some therapies, it took a while for that memory to start showing me what was, you know, not, you know, first thing was my name, remembering my parents and my sibling. The second thing was, and then beginning to remember the actual experience that happened. But it wasn't so much for me. It wasn't so like, that was, you know, that's so far out there. You know, I believe that, oh yeah, okay, something like that could happen, you know, to anybody.
So how long did you hold on to this story before you came out of the quote unquote near death experience closet?
Well, I told people that I trusted throughout the year, throughout the years. I never really felt like just, you know, coming on a show like this and telling anybody until actually last year. I wrote a blog about it. I felt like I needed to write about it. So this is back in 1997 when it actually happened. Mm-hmm. And, you know, back then near-death experiences as, you know, yeah, right. So
not a thing, especially not a thing by sane people, apparently, you know,
right.
It was not accepted at all.
And so I began to see, you know, other videos coming out and people sharing their stories. I'm like, okay, well, this will at least give me some kind of avenue or some kind of permission that it is okay to tell it. And so it wasn't like, oh, I need everybody to know that there's fairies, or I need to be famous or anything like that. I mean, that's never, you know, never been a part of me, but it was more like, it was more personal, be able to, I guess in a way, kind of like just get it out there, you know, like talk therapy, or just being able to have somebody hear my story. So that happened about a year ago.
And I have to ask you, why did you feel the urge to have to tell this story? Because this does, you know, this opens you up to ridicule. It opens you up to a bunch of things that, you know, for people listening, and I hear this all the time, people are like, oh, they just want to be famous. Oh, they have a book to sell. Oh, they want this or that. And I'm going, this is not easy, guys. I sit here and have these conversations with souls who've gone through this. And this is not an easy process publicly to talk about. And, you know, I had my own struggles just doing this show originally when I first launched it. I can only imagine what it was like for you guys to do what you're doing. So what drew you to, like, you know what, I'm going to put myself out there?
I think a lot of it has to do with me having trouble expressing myself throughout the years. I mean, one of my creativity avenues has been acting, in the process of, you know, doing body work and helping people. But it's true. I mean, I had somebody that I knew, here on the island. He wrote me, I think, I don't know, 6 months ago, or I don't know, but he basically said, oh, I saw your near-death experience. I thought you were giving an audition. And I was like, okay. So in a way, yeah, there's ridicule, but there's also, you know, people that you've known for years. You're like, who is this guy now? You know, I've shared it with some of my family members that have been very open to it. And others have, you know, they don't not talk to me anymore, but they don't bring it up.
Sure.
So yeah, you are putting yourself out there. And I guess I felt like I just needed to say it. I don't know. I'm not trying to be too surface level, but sometimes when you're holding stuff in, you have to get it out. So for me, it's always been writing. Like, I love writing. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, telling my story throughout the years to a few people I trusted. And then just saying, okay, well, let me just see if there's any reception. You know, I don't care if anybody believes me, even if I'm just being completely selfish and doing this for myself, I've got to tell it. You know, like an artist, and you're an artist, you just mm-hmm. want to tell your story, right? You want to get it out there. So I don't know if you can relate to that or not.
I can't. No, I can completely. And it is, it's admirable. You putting yourself out there the way you have, because it is not easy. And I want people listening to understand that, people watching to understand that anytime someone steps up in front of a camera to tell their truth, which is not possibly a popular truth by everybody, it takes a certain level of, as they say, cojones, to put themselves out there, because you obviously don't have a gain out of this. You know, you're not even pushing a book. Not that there's a huge amount of gain in books, by the way. People think you're going to get rich unless your last name is King or Rowling. You're not going to really make a lot of money in books. But I just want people to really understand that. Now, after this, since 97, did you do research on near-death experiences? Did you kind of talk to anybody else about that, that had a near death, just try to figure out what happened, or you were just very comfortable with what had happened and kind of explained it to yourself?
I was very comfortable with what happened. Not right away. It took some time to get comfortable with it, but then it became an experience that was very sacred to me. And so I didn't want to have it polluted by other people's thoughts and polluted by what other other people's opinions. So that's part of the reason why I had held on to it for so long. I didn't do research. I didn't even really know that people had near-death experiences, I think, until later on. And I think, can't remember what the first one I heard. It was way out there. Some guy, I can't remember. Somebody who had done research, he had several near-death experiences. I can't remember his name off the top of my head. And then... and so I let it go. And then the first one that I had seen, maybe 2 or 3 years ago. And then I started to watch videos, and then there was more people that came out, and then there was more people. And, some people, you can tell you can feel their authenticity, others maybe not so much. And so I just kind of, I listened to those, more of those people that I felt, it resonated with me, I guess you could say. That truth resonated with me.
Well, so let me ask you, when you came back, how did you change? Did your point of view on life change? On point of view of your existence change? Any of that?
It took a while. It wasn't an overnight, awakening. Oh, everything is beautiful now, because I was experiencing so much pain. I became interested in the physical body, and I became interested in how we can self-heal our physical body. And I had, it took me about 6 to 9 months, because I found this gentleman who is a network chiropractor who basically supplied the energy to be able to have my body remember its own self-healing mechanism. So when I saw that happening, when I saw that my nervous system started to change and the pain started to subside more and more after every treatment, I became interested in the physical body and how it could heal. At the same time, I was experiencing incredible amount of emotions, internal pain, traumas, everything that I wanted to suppress prior my near-death experience. So then I became interested in forms of healing. And as I've been going through that process for many years, then I've, there's been openings within me, and I've seen how important things are, how important it is to treat other people, to be of service to other people, to treat myself well. So these aren't some grand big changes in some eyes, but they are very important ones. I believe that being able to love myself, being able to find ways to be kinder and to other people, I don't know. There's a lot of lessons that have come along the way. I don't know if there's anything specific that you want to hear.
Well, let me ask you this, because I think everyone who's living has to deal with pain and trauma. It's kind of part of the package in one way, shape, or form. Some bigger, some smaller. But you were suppressing it. And after this event, it was kind of brought up into the light, not only the physical pain that you went through, but like you were saying, a lot of these things had to come up to the light for you to deal with them, for you to process them. Do you think that this accident was a sort of gift to you in your life?
Yeah, I think everything that comes into our lives is a gift, no matter how hard it is, no matter how beautiful it is. And so finding the gift in any experience, it took me a while to find the gift in that experience. And I believe even just being able to express and write down and then tell my story, I have discovered more and more that it has been a gift, looking back, that I did have another chance to be here on this planet, that I did have another chance to self-heal. So yeah, I believe it's a huge gift. I believe it. Everything at this point is a gift, no matter how hard it is for people or for me, whoever.
And as you've been going through your studies over the years in regards to healing and the body, but I'm assuming during those, and please correct me if I'm wrong, when you're going through those trainings, you've kind of come across more spiritual conversations, more spiritual ideas. I mean, if you go into healing techniques, spirituality kind of goes into it. Has your experience and your training over the years opened you up to new ideas in regards to spirituality, why we're here, karma, you know, all of these kind of things?
Yes and no, but I meaning yes, meaning it has opened me up completely to new ideas and about, you know, why we're here, but then that will change and I'll be challenged about a certain belief. Like, for example, you know, we can have the idea of oneness, right? That everything is one and we're all one and we're all connected,
mm-hmm.
which is something that I hold near and dear to my heart.
Mm-hmm.
However, just having that idea that everything is one, we're going to have to see the beauty and we're also going to have to see the grotesque. So it's not just a concept. It's something that becomes our experience. If we have the idea that all is one, then, you know, if we don't like Republicans or we don't like Democrats, for example, then we're going to have to see that as one. If we don't like the war that's happening, you mm-hmm. know, we're going to have to see that as part of the one. But I don't know if that makes sense.
It makes perfect sense.
Yeah. So if there's an opening within me, if I believe that, you know, for example, that we can communicate with trees, and I've had experiences where I communicate with the nature world, and I do to this day, then there might be something that happens, like, you know, a tree falls on my car, so it's like you have to. It's like the highest, what I've discovered is your highest ideals and your highest beliefs about how the world is will always somewhat challenge you to see if you really believe in what you believe in.
Gotcha. So you got to take the good with the bad.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, you do. But it's more than that. I mean,
sure.
I see that there's light and dark in the world and good and bad. But I also believe that we're moving into a time where darkness will be eliminated. I mean, it's about the light coming fully into the full spectrum of this world. So
what was your biggest takeaway from this whole experience? And now apparently the experience that keeps on giving, because I'm imagining the second you had to come public with this, it was a whole new set of lessons and things and challenges you had to overcome. So what's the biggest takeaway from this for you?
The biggest takeaway is appreciation, and that's become my prayer. My prayer has become, you know, some people say gratitude or appreciation. So that's appreciation for everything, not just the things I want, not just my desires, but appreciation for the people that are in my life, for just the tiny little things, you know, my body and which isn't, you know, tiny, but but you know, just ongoing learning to be in that state of appreciation and gratitude. That's my biggest takeaway, I would say.
I have a question that a lot of people ask me all the time, and I'd love to hear your point of view on it, is why do we have hardships in our life? Why do we get challenged so much? Why do we have traumas? Why do we have pain in our lives? If, quote unquote, the God or source loves us so much, why do we have to go through that? Is the question I get asked a lot. I'd love to hear your point of view.
I believe, Alex, it could be a number of different things. I think that we're challenged to, basically, we're being challenged to show us more of who we are. And when I say that, the hard times, the pain, the trauma, being able to go through that, being able to experience that and face it, is always going to bring more light. It's always going to bring more joy. It's always going to bring more happiness at some point. So no matter what anybody's going through, no matter what I was going through, there would be a moment where I would experience an expansion and see, okay, there is joy in this. Why does that happen? I don't know. I honestly don't know. I think I really believe that we're being challenged, like even today, to be of greater help to others and to help serve others that have gone through similar experiences. And it doesn't have to be the exact same experience, mm-hmm. but it can be a similar experience, and being able to serve, to learn how to serve and to learn to be authentic and to be real and to be there for people. So why does that happen? I don't know what the mechanism is. I don't have the answers.
Sure.
You know, I'm not an expert in that regard, but I don't think I have to be, because really, I mean, we're all learning here. We're all learning what it is to be, you know, a human in these bodies on Earth,
mm-hmm.
and we're all doing the best we can. So we have to give ourselves a break and just be curious, you know, because life always gets better, and it's always, somebody's always experiencing something worse than you are. So
yes, without question. Now, after the accident, you said you started going into the healing arts. Can you talk a little bit about what the work you do now and how your near-death experience kind of affected you in the way of going into that work?
Basically, it affected me. It made me curious about how the body self-heals. So then I began to take massage therapy courses. I took a whole program. I learned various modalities. Back in 2000, I had learned quantum healing from one of the first people that actually did that.
Mm-hmm.
And this was just 3 years after my near-death experience. And she taught a small group of people to learn how to do that. And so it had developed over the years. I had my own practice. I had my own practice in LA and Florida and a few other places. People began to say, oh, I feel amazing. You know, what are you doing? I'm just like, I'm just doing body work. You know, I'm not doing anything special. So then I began to kind of blend the two, you could say, of quantum healing and body work as I was touching people. And it has evolved to where I don't actually physically touch people, but I work with people remotely now. You could call it quantum healing, but I don't like to put a label on it. It's basically looking at where people need to, where, and it's not me doing it. I could say that it's basically, yeah, it's them, because they're ready to make a change, and it's that greater power that wants to help. So I don't necessarily like to take credit for it, but people do show up. When they're ready to make a shift in their lives, maybe, you know, they're a spiritual seeker and they still have stuff going on from their past. And so I can see what's going on inside the body, and I can see what's going on around the body. And and the energy is very respectful. I could say it's source, and it's kind of attuned to this person specifically.
Mm-hmm.
And if they're ready to have a release in that area, whatever that area of a resistance is, then they will. If they're not, if there's still a lesson there, then it won't happen. But often, most often, people are ready to have some kind of release, you could say, or they're ready to move to another level spiritually. And there's a space for that to happen when people come to me.
That's all. I'm going to ask a few questions I ask all my guests. What is your definition of living a good life?
My definition of living a good life is very simple. It's loving acts of deeds. I think living in Hawaii has really taught me that, because the people here are so incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Being grateful for everything, no matter what comes into my life, and seeing the gift. But basically, just being able to serve without expectation, being able to help people without any expectation, and just doing it from my heart. That I believe is the good life.
How do you define God?
Again, I don't really know for sure what God is. God could be a she.
I don't think it's a he or a she, but I understand what you mean.
Yeah. So as far as my experience, and even going back to my near-death experience, just this idea that God is love, God is everywhere. And I know that can be kind of mental for people, but honestly, my experience with God is just having a conversation with God and being able to see that God is in everything, and being also curious and not knowing that I don't know, I have all the answers, and that maybe someday God will reveal him, her, itself to everyone in some way. And I hope that happens for everybody.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
I think it's to be happy. Yeah. I mean, we're here for a short time.
Very.
Very short time. Yeah.
Very, very short time.
And to find ways to do that.
And where can people find out more about the work that you're doing?
They can find out. I have a YouTube channel, a small little YouTube channel, where I just kind of explain things that have helped me in my life. And I also have a website people can go to, read a blog. They can sign up for a session. I only take donations. And that's radicalheartworks.com. So that's basically where I can be found right now.
And Tyler, do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Find ways to enjoy your life, no matter what you're going through right now. And I don't know what that is for anybody. And I don't claim to be some know-it-all, but, you know, take care of yourself and take care of the ones you love. And you're already doing the best you can, so you might as well have fun along the way.
Oh, that was beautiful. Thank you again so much for sharing your story and for the work that you're doing in the world to help people along this insane journey that we call life. So I appreciate you, my friend.
I appreciate you too, Alex. Thank you so much for letting me be here.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.